I think the concept of a face transplantation, even to me, who's heavily involved in this, that's very surreal. When I see a deformity, I'm already thinking of what's the underlying problem. What is the skeletal dismantling that's occurred, and how we're going to put these bones together? And if we're missing soft tissue, where are we going to take this tissue from, and how are we going to make a tongue? Okay, open your mouth for me. Okay, just relax and feel your lips here. My name is Eduardo Rodriguez, and I'm chair of the Hans-Jörg Wyss Department of Plastic Surgery. We have performed the most extensive soft tissue face transplant in medical history. I was not accepted to medical school. When we are not accepted into something, we often want to block it from our minds and kind of choose another path and leave this thing behind. I began my professional career as a dentist. I never thought I'd pursue medicine again. The opportunity presented itself to get a medical degree in your oral surgery training. I really wanted to do something bigger. I decided to use oral surgery to help me build a career as a plastic surgeon. Patrick's initial injury occurred in September 2001. He's a volunteer firefighter in Senatobia, Mississippi. The roof collapsed on Patrick. His oculoplastic surgeon saw me lecture at a surgical conference. He came up to me and said, "I have a patient that I think could benefit from your assistance." The outside surface and the fat that's between the muscles and the skin was burnt off. Most people tend to focus on the 26 hours of the actual surgical operation, but there's a lot of prep time that goes before that. I practice rehearsals with cadavers first. And then the final step is to actually practice on a brain-dead donor. Our core surgical team is divided into two groups. The recipient op team removes Patrick's scarred face. The donor team procures the face. When you remove the face, that's called ischemia. The face is not receiving blood from the donor. So the goal is to get that face connected as soon as possible. The longer the time, the more potential for rejection. In Patrick's case, it was 1 hour. That's pretty fast. We stabilize the bones with plates and screws. You need to have kind of anatomical memory of where things should go. But there's also a component of artistic impression and feeling comfortable in that zone. It's not something that everyone can do.
The reason why it's considered the most comprehensive is the amount of tissue that was included all the way around the neck, all the way up to the top of the crown, including the ears, the eyelids, the lips, the nose. The muscles, the nerves, blood vessels all come together as one unit.
It's heavy.
How heavy is it?
I would say probably close to 10 pounds. When you cross the barrier of innovation, it doesn't come without a lot of criticism.
They're taking big risks. This is not your routine elective procedure. I always say there has to be some kind of celestial intervention for these things to go well. We can rehearse and we can practice, but at the end of the day, you have to find the ideal donor on an ideal day and for this thing to come together flawlessly.
You're trying to do something which has failed. Not only that, that the patient has died. Why would you consider doing that?
We can help out a lot of individuals that are severely disfigured. A lot of them are people that protect our freedoms.
Patients that have deformities, whether it's from trauma, from cancer, or from congenital birth defects, everybody wants to look as best as they can. And I think anything less than that is unacceptable.
Hang those lips which I have kissed, I know not how oft. Where be your jibes now? Your gambols, your songs?
When that individual's gone, those material aspects that make up our body are no longer part of what made that individual. The voice is gone, the mannerisms are gone. It's nothing more than just flesh, which could be used to help out a lot of other people. When we look at Patrick and his donor, there's still a combination of two individuals. It definitely has the donor nose, which was not modified. But if you look at the surrounding adaptation of the soft tissues to Patrick's skeleton, they're two distinct individuals.
I'm here today because I want others to see that there is hope beyond the injury. If sharing my story helps just one person explore the possibility of face transplants, then it's been worth it.
He's in a good place right now. His speaking has dramatically improved. He's becoming much more independent. The definition of organ transplant continues to expand to other tissues and other organs. We can transplant an entire hand. There have been larynx, uterus, penis transplants. We already have the capacity as a race to be generous, and we need to extend the organ donation process to face.
People say that's crazy, that's mad science. Right now it's not touchable. Think about the number of sacrifices that people made to land on the moon, the number of practices and exercise and even deaths. And look where we are today, landing a rover in Mars. Sure, why not?
Science is the foundation of everything that we do.
The miracle becomes practical when it's understood as something methodical.